Well, good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for all coming today. My name is Melanie Robinson, and I'm the UK's Executive Director on the Bank Board for the Whole World Bank Group. And I'm delighted to be with you here today to release the second report in the Inspection Panel's Emerging Lessons series. The panel, as many of you know, was created by the Bank's Board of Executive Directors in 1993 to receive complaints from people who believe they're being harmed by World Bank-funded projects. The panel was the first independent accountability mechanism at the International Financial Institution, and since its creation has played a critical role in fostering accountability at the bank. In addition to its important investigations work, the panel also helps promote institutional learning. The Emerging Lessons series is an example of that, and comes at an important time as the bank begins to implement the new environmental and social framework. So the Emerging Lessons series looks back over the panel's caseload and identifies lessons that can help enhance the bank's approach to development. It's organized around the most recurrent issues in the bank's cases. The series started in April with the release of a report on emerging lessons from involuntary resettlement cases. The report the panel is releasing today identifies lessons from investigations relating to the bank finance projects affecting Indigenous people. Currently, there are approximately 370 million self-identified Indigenous peoples in some 90 countries worldwide. As I'm sure this audience knows since you're here at this event, they're among the world's most vulnerable, marginalized, and disadvantaged groups. Despite accounting for less than 5% of the global population, they constitute about 15% of the extreme poor and a substantial proportion of the world's population with insecure access to food. All this points to the need for the bank to give its Indigenous people's policy the importance and significance it deserves, and I'm sure the panel's new report will help greatly in that regard. Here with me today to discuss the report and its meaning for the bank are three panelists who are extremely knowledgeable about the challenges posed by development projects affecting Indigenous people. First, Gonzalo Castro de la Mata. Forgive my Spanish accent, Gonzalo. Thank you. Gracias. Gonzalo was appointed to the inspection panel on December 16, 2013, and became its chairman on November 1, 2014. Second, Maninder Gill. Maninder joined the World Bank in 1995, and since July 2014 has been director of the Social, Urban, Rural, and Resilience Global Practice. I think you have some colleagues here in the audience, Maninder. And third, Albert Barume. Albert is a specialist in Indigenous peoples' issues and currently the chairperson and president of the UN Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous Peoples, so really one of the world's experts in this area, and we're delighted to have you here with us today, Albert. It's a pleasure to have you all here today, and we'll start with Gonzalo with an overview of the Indigenous Peoples Report, and then we'll hear from Maninder and then Albert before beginning our questions and answer session, which is when we turn the floor to you and you get a chance to grill our panelists until 4:30. Over to you, Gonzalo.
Thank you very much, Melanie, and it's great to know that your Spanish is perfect. So I will have a fairly short PowerPoint, about 12 to 15 minutes, trying to summarize the report that you have there with you. Very briefly first, what is the inspection panel? We were created in 1993 to receive complaints regarding harm caused by bank projects and to ensure compliance with bank policies and procedures. It's important to mention that we are independent from bank management, reporting directly to the board of directors, and we were, as Melanie mentioned, the first of its kind across the international financial institutions. Today, there are 17 of these mechanisms. In our 22-year history, we have received 113 requests as of September of this year, and right now we have 8 ongoing cases. Now, something very important for us is how do we define effectiveness? The first dimension is, of course, redress of harm. When a project is causing harm, then that harm needs to be redressed. But perhaps as important is the lessons learned for the World Bank Group. And in the past, this has taken the form of policy clarifications, better guidance to staff, strengthened safeguard capacity, and highlighting broader development issues at the institutional level, because our reports are discussed at the board level. So the Emerging Lessons series is It's our attempt to make the learning more explicit by reflecting of our 22 years of experience. And with this, we help build the knowledge base and contribute to more effective development. In this series, we will release four reports. The first one is on involuntary resettlement, second one on indigenous peoples, third one on environmental assessment, and the fourth one is on consultation and disclosure. And together, these four issues cover most of the cases that we have received and most of the safeguard policies of the World Bank. So last spring meetings, we released the involuntary resettlement report, and today this is what you have with you, the indigenous peoples. Now, the methodology we use is fairly straightforward. What we look is, we look at the 113 requests we receive. We have investigated 34 of these, and 18 of them have indigenous peoples issues, so more than half, slightly more than half. What we do is, within each one of those reports, we look at the recurrent issues. What are those issues that keep coming up over and over and over? And we do what we call the frequency analysis. And you have in this graph the frequency of the issues that are coming up recurrently, and they become the basis for our lessons. So there are six main issues that keep coming up, and those are the six main lessons that you have in your report, that we have in this report. Then we organize these lessons along the stages of a project cycle. So in yellow, you have during project preparation, we have four main lessons, and for each lesson, we have sub-issues. Then during project implementation, we have one lesson with two issues. And then in terms of the long-term benefits, meaning to what extent the bank's long-term policy objective with indigenous peoples has been met, we have one lesson with two issues. So what I will do now is very quickly try to summarize these lessons and the issues, illustrating each lesson with an example. So lesson number one during project preparation, proper process of identification and the use of appropriate terminology helps protect indigenous people's rights and ensure that indigenous peoples benefit from project outcomes. So this has to do with identification. Two issues related to this. The first one, proper assessment when project-affected people qualify and the indigenous peoples in accordance with the policy. The example comes from Kenya. It's a recent case in the Kenya Electricity Example Expansion Project, where indigenous people's policy was not triggered because pastoralists, the Maasai, were not considered indigenous peoples by the bank. The Maasai then were unable to engage in fully informed consultations around the project. And the result was that the Maasai attachment to land, territory, and resources were not fully considered, resulting in the harms that we mentioned in our report. Second issue related to identification has to do with the application of alternative terminologies for indigenous peoples without diluting the standard of protection afforded by the policy. The example also comes from Kenya, the Natural Resources Management Project, where in the middle of a project, the project shifted from using the term indigenous peoples to vulnerable and marginalized groups. The project, the panel funded project in compliance with the policy, because the policy does not require, does not force projects to use the term indigenous people. However, the lesson here is that in this particular case, for the Sengwer, the term indigenous peoples is central to their self-identity and effective protection of their customary rights. So by not using the term, the project actually weakened their rights. Second lesson, during project preparation, still, free, prior, and informed consultations leading to broad community support are central to protecting indigenous peoples and their rights. The first issue has to do with consultations. Indigenous peoples' consultation and participation should be inclusive and involve representative institutions and decision-making processes. The example comes from Honduras, the Land Administration Project, where the project put in place a parallel system that was at odds with the Garifunas people's established system of representation. So the Garifunas have their own system of representation. This was not recognized, and the parallel system was put in place. As a result, divided and marginalized community, potentially weakening their claims for collective title to ancestral lands. And of course, this led to a decrease in support for the project. Second issue related to free, prior, and informed consultations has to do with full disclosure of project information. And this has to be in a culturally appropriate form, manner, and language. So it's not just a matter of disclosing information, but it has to be in the appropriate form. The example comes from the Nepal Power Development Project. It's a recent case where English and Nepali documents were disclosed late and no translation into indigenous languages. So as a result, there was a spread of misinformation and there was an increased opposition to the project that even remains to date. And the third issue here has to do with ensuring broad community support for the project and its objectives. The example comes from this Papua New Guinea Smallholder Agricultural Development Project. And the policy requires the FPIC requires a free, prior, and informed consultations leading to broad community support. So here, you actually had community support, but there was no evidence how this broad community support was achieved. There was widespread interest in growing oil palm, and this was equated with broad community support. But there was an incomplete understanding of the project because the full informed consultations did not take place, and this led to weakened project support. So in other words, the people wanted the project, but they were not fully informed about what this was about. Third lesson, comprehensive assessments are necessary to understand potential impacts on indigenous peoples. And these assessments have two forms. The first one is social assessment. Comprehensive social assessments are essential for analyzing both benefits and harms. The example also comes from the same project in PNG, where social assessments did not contain sufficient information on indigenous peoples' customary leadership, decision-making structures, and conflict resolution processes. As a result, there was reduced opportunities for indigenous peoples to influence project design, mitigation measures, and resulting benefits. And the end result was the community support for a project actually weakened. Second issue, in terms of assessments, is not just social, but also legal and policy frameworks and implementation capacity. So again, the example from Honduras Land Administration, there were weaknesses in the legal analysis of the project and subsequent changes to it not adequately analyzed during implementation. The result was the collective land rights were potentially weakened, and this also led to decreased project support. Second example, from the Kenya Natural Resources Management Project, the implementing agency, the Kenya Forestry Service, lacked experience with community approaches. So conflict arose between the indigenous people's communities regarding management and access to resources because the agency didn't have the capacity or experience to deal with these issues. Now, on the positive side, this case actually led for the bank to host a national dialogue on customary land rights, and this is something that is today ongoing. Fourth lesson, during project preparation, the provisions in indigenous people's plans are crucial to mitigating impacts and generating long-term benefits for indigenous people. So the policy requires the preparation of an indigenous people's plans. Something that we have found is that some projects fail to develop the indigenous people's plans when required. The example comes from the Panama Land Administration Project, where no standalone IPP was prepared, and therefore there was no participatory development process. This led to the inability to deal with conflicts for land issues, for land use that unfolded later on. Again, on the positive side, the World Bank, as a result of this case, supported an action plan to resolve pending land issues in Panama. Second issue, ensuring the inclusion of indigenous people's policy, the indigenous people's plan principles and components in the project design, even when a standalone IPP is not required. Again, from PNG, if the project deals specifically with indigenous peoples, the policy does not require the preparation of the indigenous people's plan. And in this case, the entirety of the project benefit indigenous people, so no plan was prepared. But the panel noted that the policy is less explicit on actually what is required in the absence of these plans. And the project had no provisions to respond to significant economic, financial, and institutional differences between indigenous peoples in various project areas, and this led to conflict. Now, moving on to project implementation, active supervision enables proper responses to changing circumstances. This sounds very obvious, but it's extremely important. Fully involving indigenous peoples in project implementation, especially when project circumstances change. The example, again, from Kenya Natural Resources Management Project, indigenous peoples were informed of a restructuring of a project after decisions were made. and as a result, there was loss of support for project and conflicts with implementing agency. Second issue, deploying social specialists throughout the project implementation. Again, very important, the specialized skills. In Panama, again, land administration project, social specialists were included very late in project implementation, and thus critical events that unfolded were not properly identified. This exacerbated conflicts related to land use, tenure, and decision making. And then in terms of the long-term impacts, the main lesson is the importance of respecting customary rights and securing culturally compatible benefits to ensure the long-term well-being of the indigenous people. So this is a long-term policy objective. Two issues here. The first one, projects must respect customary rights to land and natural resources. Example from the Democratic Republic of Congo, this project to support a forestry sector. The indigenous people's policy was not applied to the pygmies living in this forest, despite the impacts of logging operations on customary use of the forest. The pygmies living in this forest fear that their access to the forest will be restricted. So they were excluded from the project. On the positive side, this led to the recognition by the bank and by the government that the pygmies were actually indigenous peoples and that they have rights to the forest. And this has led to a very robust process now of support of pygmies in the DRC, the forestry sector. The final issue has to do with providing the culturally appropriate benefits. So the benefit has to be culturally appropriate. Example come from Cambodia, forest concession management and control pilot project. Primary emphasis on technical and financial aspects of forest concessions without adequate attention to vital interests of indigenous peoples in these forest resources. As a result, there was an exclusive focus on reforming concessions, which led to lack of alternative approaches, including community forestry, which is what indigenous peoples require. So what are some of the concluding observations in our report? First, we need to mention a caveat here, which is we deal with challenging projects. We deal with projects when there is a problem. So the panel cases reflecting challenging projects, and this may not reflect the overall portfolio of the World Bank. So there may be some projects out there that are actually doing lots of good things for indigenous peoples. But nevertheless, these are very important lessons because they have been recognized by bank management in the review of the safeguard policies and in other fora. So the first concluding observation is that the indigenous people's policy is among the most complex of all safeguards because of its rigorous and specialized requirements for consultations, buy-in, and sensitivities related to access to resources. So this is a really important policy that has to be taken very seriously. Second, most lessons in this report relate to the project preparation stage, highlighting the need to get it right from the beginning. You may recall when we released the resettlement report that many of the lessons were during the implementation. So things go wrong during implementation where you are moving people around. Here, most of the lessons are during the project preparation stage. So you really have to get things right from the beginning. The third one is greater expertise needs to be deployed to capture the specificities of indigenous peoples, their attachment to land and resources. Again, expertise is critical. Social, anthropological expertise is critical. And then finally, on the positive side, the World Bank has responded positively to many of our findings. As a result, has adjusted practice. Three examples. In the DRC, as I mentioned, the recognition of the pygmies resulted in rights to forests granted to them and a new approach of engagement in the sector. In Kenya, following the investigation of the Natural Resources Management Project, the bank hosted a national dialogue with the government and affected indigenous peoples on customary land and resource rights, and this is ongoing, and hopefully it's going to result in greater recognition to their land rights. And in Panama, a bank action plan to support the resolution of pending land rights issues of indigenous peoples in Panama. So this has had already some positive influence on the bank's practice. So with that, I conclude, and I hope that this will be useful and welcome to our colleagues in bank management. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Gonzalo. Fascinating. Now I turn the floor to Maninder.
So Thanks a lot, Gonzalo. This was a very, very good presentation. And more importantly, this is an excellent report. Thanks also for the very consultative process that the inspection panel used. We had a discussion, several of our comments were taken into account, and the report is not good for that, for the fact that you took our comments into account. It's a very good report, generally, but it's a report with very simple, crisp, clear, and very powerful and useful messages. So this is something which I think our practice and all of us working on social issues, especially on issues of development that is inclusive of indigenous peoples, this would be something that's mandatory reading for us. So I really would like to congratulate the panel and everyone who worked on the report for producing something that's really going to add to the body of operational knowledge on the subject. I consider this policy, you mentioned that it's complex, it's important, it's difficult, it's challenging. I also consider this policy very important for another reason. As most of you know, in the new environmental and social framework, we are expanding our definition of vulnerable groups who would be covered. So it's not going to be only people who are displaced due to involuntary resettlement or who are indigenous, but will encompass a whole broad range of vulnerability. So, and there are not going to be individual policies on that. It's going to be one umbrella framework that's going to cover all sorts of vulnerability. Whereas this is one on which we have a dedicated policy. And therefore, you know, how well we do in terms of implementing this policy is really important and very instructive on what kind of lessons we learned for addressing the broader vulnerability agenda. So in a way, this policy is a litmus test. It's the toughest one, so it's a high bar. But if we are going to promote and be part of disability inclusive development, LGBTI inclusive development, or development that doesn't discriminate based on race, gender, location, age, sexual orientation, religious beliefs, then we better do a really good job on addressing a vulnerability on which we have such elaborate policy provisions and guidelines. So in that sense, it's a very important policy for us. I got exposed to this policy and these issues relatively early in my life. I was 25 years old when I was made in charge of the Narmada project in India, which was one of the well-known environmental and social, at that time, I think in hindsight it had some redeeming features, but at that time when I entered the project, it was a disaster. It was 7-8 years into implementation. There was not a resettlement plan that was prepared. There was no indigenous people's plan. And I was 25, just about to turn 26, really raring to go. I was made project manager for one of the three states, the one which had the first set of impacts, but no benefits. So our state was kind of a marginal player and stuck with the adverse impacts. So I remember as I was joining, they said the bank is now really, it wants to make amends. So it has created an entitlement framework, which needs to be disseminated widely among all the indigenous groups so that they know what their rights are. And one of my first job, I was also the district chief. I was in the civil service, so I could, you know, I was also the head of administration. So I made sure on my second, third day that the postmaster general ensures that all of these packets with their entitlements in three languages are delivered to all of the villages, 33 villages, 2,800 families, all of them were supposed to deliver this packet, which explained the project, you know, all the entitlements, all of this. And then I set out to meet these people on my third, fourth day. I had to go by car, then by jeep, then walk for a day, and then I reached the first village. It was late night, so in the morning we had a meeting, and I said, did you all get the packets, the letters? And they said, they couldn't understand. I said, you know, letters, we sent you letters. And then All of them nodded. There were like 200 of them. All of them nodded. They said, yes, yeah. And I said, great, the system works. And they took them out of their bags, their whatever. And they had, none of them had been opened because they had never ever received a letter in their life. And they didn't know. They just got this package and they were proud that they had it. And then that set me thinking that I really need to reorient the way I think about development and issues if I have to work here. Because all my, and then I thought, you know, oral kind of presentation is useful. So I spent the next 2 hours giving them all the, painting the picture of the project, what it will do, and there'll be irrigation, you will get 5 acres. And that way of communicating made absolutely no sense to them. And they had no questions. And then one elder said to the interpreter, this guy needs help. So he said, you know, he's come so far, but and I think we can help him, but he needs help. He's like, he's talking of all these crazy things. So in any case, just a pointer that a lot of our assumptions as, and not only, this is not the world of indigenous people, this is one group. These are the Vasavas of the Narmada Valley in the Maharashtra part. So it's not to paint a picture that that's what the indigenous world looks like. There's a whole range. But it did set me thinking that I have to think completely differently about these issues. And I think therefore, for us, the reminder you have in the report on, you know, culturally appropriate in a form and language they can understand. And there are huge challenges here, you know, with all of us here measuring the time it takes from PCN to effectiveness to enter the world of indigenous people and consult meaningfully in a way they can relate to, understand, imbibe, comment on, reflect upon. It's a huge challenge. So start early, be mindful, try to get into their reality each and every time. I don't think you are ever an indigenous people's expert. You have to try again each and every time, depending on the community and the context you are dealing with. The other point about recognizing the customary rights, again, these people throughout the valley were characterized as squatters. Some were owners, a few, others were all squatters. And we refer to them as squatters. And then 6 months into my tenure, I realized that all of them actually had been granted rights to their lands, but that was through an order issued in Delhi, which had not made its way to, people in Bombay, the state capital, knew about it, but it had not worked its way into then actually granting them title family by family. So they were actually legitimate owners, but we characterized them as squatters for months. And then I had to kind of turn the wheels of bureaucracy into motion to say, they are not squatters. We haven't done our job to give them titles that they deserve. So the point about making sure that customary titles, rights are fully recognized. So, you know, again, small point, but very important to be aware of. So then there are some challenges. So this is, you know, just the point that the report points to a lot of these issues that we need to be careful about when we are dealing with indigenous peoples. But then there are a few challenges. You know, the report talks about being flexible in our approach, being adaptive, because the reality changes. And currently, our bank instruments don't really allow that. So again, that's something, the report has some amazing lessons. And then there are some we need to continue to work on. We do want to capture everything in the form of a report that's well-written, clear, it's disclosed in the info shop as well as in the community. And then it's very difficult to change it. Whereas the reality changes on, you know, day two, things start changing. So how do we create an environment where these instruments and plans are more flexible? My final point is about, you know, getting into the mode of, I felt that this is such an important and complex area of development that we can only succeed if we co-produce with our indigenous people, colleagues, friends, counterparts. This is not something you know, the normal model of development institution, client, and then beneficiaries. There has to be a lot of co-production. There are some very interesting models and lessons emerging. We have the dedicated grant mechanism, which is building capacity, working with indigenous peoples on what makes sense in their context to build capacity in ways that they can use and relate to help them level the playing field in the development process. So that's a very interesting, very promising area of work that's happening around the world. We do have a project that's aimed at indigenous people-centric development in Panama, which is now, it's under preparation. It'll come up with some interesting lessons on a new way of thinking about these issues, and then we'll see how, whether that's a more, that's a promising model. I also think that we need to get, while we do need to comply with these policies, we need to bring our indigenous peoples, colleagues, Benito is here right now, so, and other colleagues, into the kitchen, because there are challenges in implementing this policy. The whole, you know, free prior informed consent. It's, to some of us, it can be a very scary notion. So rather than us figuring it out and then doing it, and then someone telling us that you completely got it wrong, or you didn't do this right or that, it would be great if we can just bring them into the fold, and we've been trying to make some efforts there where we work together, we share with them not only what we are trying to do and our achievements, but also our struggles and our frustrations. And I do have this conversation with many of my my colleagues who are indigenous representatives that, you know, we don't want our teams to avoid indigenous people's inclusive development because it's too complex. So you don't want a team to say, I need your help. How can I avoid indigenous people in my project? Please help me carve out a project that doesn't go anywhere near them. That's the last thing we want. And if we want to create an indigenous people-centric, focused, friendly development, then we need to work together. And that's an effort which I think, and there, the inspection panel again has showed some very interesting models and examples of where you'd followed that model, we came up with great solutions, and we would like to do more of the same so that we can all work together to promote really sustainable, indigenous people-centered, focused, sustainable development. Thank you.
Thank you, Maninder. And now I call on Albert Barume to speak.
Good afternoon, everyone. And I'd like to thank the organizer for the inspection panel for organizing this and for inviting me. Really appreciate the invitation. I think also maybe on behalf of Africa, thank the panel for so many African people in the report. We actually have the front. The front page is not always is that we have the front page. I really have to say it's. I also really think, and this is not a flattery at all, but I personally think it's very useful that the inspection panel actually takes that exercise to bring out some substance out of its work. In terms of guiding the practice, because I mean, its mandate actually enables it to look at things differently, and that knowledge generation, I think, it will be key, particularly for the continent I am from. I would like to make three major comments, really, small comments. No, they're not major. Small comments on the inspection panel report, which is going out. The first one is really to do with something which is central in my small understanding on indigenous people's rights. And it comes through the report, And that issue is the capacity. It's an issue of capacity. The second point is, it's also come strongly through the report. It's on what I call a right-based approach, interfacing the anthropological approach, which really comes also through this report. And lastly, some sort of a legacy. I think there's a legacy from the operational policy 4.10 that probably the new ESS 7 will have to take on. So this will be my really three comments. And I'm going to really try to be brief on this. I promise to be brief. The first point on the capacity, the report does clearly say, shows how government officials in different ministries, World Bank staff, including even civil society, really grappling with the concept sometime and the whole understanding of indigenous people's rights. It's key for me. Why? Because before I actually joined the United Nations Expert Mechanism on the Rights of Indigenous People, I had been doing the same work for the African Commission on Human and People's Rights. And it's during that specific time that we had to conceptualize what that concept actually meant in Africa, if at all, if it really meant something. That is something on many continents will still has to be built upon. And I really like that the inspection panel is bringing that up, understanding that. Because indigenous people are not just the poor guy you guys walk on. They are not just the guy without housing. They're not just the guy without access to education. They're not just the guy without shelter, without access to health, to sanitation and water. They're not just that. That's, of course, an important aspect of the rights that they are denied. Sometimes they have no access to. But what makes their claim particular goes beyond that. Actually, there's what we see as sign of poverty are consequences of what went wrong. And in my view, it's very critical to grasp that. What went wrong in many cases are some historical thing that went into having prejudiced view about certain livelihoods. And those prejudiced view led to land dispossession because those way of traditionally occupying and using land were seen as not good enough and therefore not legally protectable. Denying people, community, of the very essence of a livelihood. When you if you understand that, when you screen the different continent, you're gonna find, of course, people who are landless, but not all the landless people have gone through that specific thing. That's what this whole setup on indigenous people was set for. So it's what we see them not accessing health, education, are actually consequences. And if you just put them in that big basket of all the poor, you might be missing the point. I had an opportunity to work on one of the inspection panel case in Kenya. And we realized exactly that. Because in that specific case, the government was offering a certain amount of everyone who was involved in the case. And all communities that were not claiming the indigenous status, but living on that land, took the offer. Except the majority of the indigenous people. Because for them, that land meant more than the commodity. So that's my second my third point. So the capacity will be really continue to be required on both sides, and I'm very glad that the bank is bringing that up. My second point, as I said, is this whole discussion on anthropological approach and the right-based approach. It's And I'm not saying this because I'm a lawyer. Really, no, definitely no. And I have absolutely nothing against anthropologists. On the contrary, I admire their work. Most of actually the work on indigenous people globally was done and continue to be done by anthropologists. But in my view, and this is a view that I have, I think there have been too much of a focus on anthropological approach to, including through the work of the inspection panel and the bank. Anthropologists brought in to analyze another tribe, understanding the internal dynamics, the decision internal dynamic, understanding the social structures, understanding how they are construed, how do they make decisions, understanding their attachment to land, which is absolutely correct. But the last 15 years, the indigenous people's claims have become crystallized into becoming solid rights. The last 15 years. So you have, through the UN, a number of instruments really coming through. You have, of course, the ILO Convention. You have the ICRC's Convention on the Rights of the Child with specific provision. You have now the Human Rights Council. I work on one of the body having three organs. My body, we are five, and each one of us represent a continent, and we are asked on a regular basis by the council to undertake a study, thematic study. We have done 9 of them on the right to health, right to education, right to decision making, right to access to justice, many others. Excuse my memory. And on all those occasions, the council asked us to dissect the right, look inside the right, understanding what makes it unique for indigenous people. And in one of those cases, for instance, we had a study on the right to education. Why we were doing that study? We realized that the universal education in Uganda, for instance, yes, was being enjoyable by most Ugandan children. But the reason the pygmy indigenous children were not enjoying it was very peculiar. It was simply because every time indigenous pygmies turn into primary school, they are mocked, ridiculed by other children. And they run away. And they end up dropping out of school. It really tells that, yes, we have those policies, universal education, but you might not be able to capture indigenous children or indigenous people issues if you don't look at it in a way. I think it will become the right-based approach is to understand that indigenous people are not right holders, that on those land they have rights. The type of right areas to be, of course, identified. That on those plant and natural resources, they have right to generate medicine and so on and so forth. That the state is somehow a duty bearer. Because that's the logic of the right-based approach. That beside the right holder, you have the duty bearer that has to provide and shift away from the charity approach, where indigenous people in some cases would just be asked to take whatever is given to them. And not engaging like any ordinary right holder would engage someone negotiating a deal with him or with them. I think it will help a lot. Now that we have the new standard, particularly with concepts like FPIC, of course, I think it will a good mixture of those both approach, both anthropological and right-based, will be absolutely critical because it also fits many countries' development agenda that I want to be people-centered, more shared growth, and so on and so forth. And my last point, really, about the legacy. In my view, Operational Policy 4.10 has had a good legacy. And let me speak only for Africa, as my comment. I mean, that because of that policy, we have had people in the presidency's office, people in the prime minister's office, people in the ministries of finance, hearing for the first time the concept indigenous people. This might really sound trivial, but it is not. And I'm sure the colleague who were involved in the negotiation on ESS 7 realized it become critical that we move beyond the traditional interlocutors, ministry working on natural resources, ministry working on traditional authorities and public administration, and engage as a key stakeholder like people in presidencies, people in prime minister's office, and people in ministries of finance, because they seem. That is something, in my view, that will, I think the policy has also really enabled, in some cases, and the inspection report is highlighting that, it has triggered interest in developing policies and legal framework. The law in Congo Brazzaville, as the first African state to pass a law on indigenous peoples, because that's how the law is called. The policy played an important role in that government decision to move and make that very unparalleled step. As I mean, the Kenyan constitution is what it is today, and because of the inspection panel work, that was also have been done. Let me finish by saying that that legacy will have to move on and continue. And when we look at the new ESS 7, I see a lot of in that standard. And we really, I think a lot of work will be on its implementation, and we look forward on the continent to ensuring it does what it should be doing. I thank you.
Well, thank you very much. I think really excellent presentations and comments from our panelists here. I hope you were as stimulated as I was there. So now the turn is yours. So please, I turn to you for comments and for questions. We have about 35 minutes, so if you keep your comment or question short, then that gives more chances to other people. Gentleman at the front, and then this gentleman at the front. If you'd like to go to the microwave, if you need translation, please both go together. Thank you.
Buenas tardes con todas y todos. Primero quiero expresar el reconocimiento al Banco Mundial por habernos permitido estar en esta reunión anual de los directores. Es la primera vez a nombre del Movimiento Indígena de Latinoamérica en representación del Foro Indígena de la Vallala, al quien les habla es Benito Calixto, un indígena de Perú.
Good afternoon to everyone. I first want to recognize and thank the bank for inviting us to participate as indigenous leaders in the annual meetings. This is the first time he's received this invitation. Benito was nominated as about 25 other global representatives from civil society to participate in these annual meetings. Benito Calixto is the coordinator of Foro Indígena Avayala, which is a Latin American-wide network of indigenous organizations.
En estos tres últimos años hemos estado participando de manera activa en el proceso de la modificación de las salvaguardas del Banco Mundial. Y hay un tema que ha sido bastante crucial en este proceso de discusión, es decir, si incorporábamos o no incorporábamos el tema del consentimiento previo, libre e informado. Entonces creo que es un logro muy importante de los pueblos indígenas que en estas nuevas políticas de salvaguarda se haya incluido, muy a pesar que al inicio había cierta resistencia para incorporarlos. Mi pregunta a los señores panelistas es la siguiente. Si bien es cierto ya tenemos estas nuevas políticas de salvaguardas, incluido el consentimiento mayor de los pueblos indígenas, es ahora cómo, cuál es el mecanismo, cómo, cuáles son las estrategias de cómo se va a implementar estas nuevas políticas del Banco Mundial y qué estamos pensando hacer de acá para adelante con los pueblos indígenas. Y yo diría, vamos a continuar el proceso, lo cortamos. Solamente esa pregunta.
As the TTL of the process. No, Benito was saying that Foro Indígena Vial and Indigenous peoples from throughout the world have been participating over the past 3 years in the safeguards policy reform process very actively. And they consider it a very important accomplishment to have achieved that the World Bank incorporate free, prior, informed consent into our safeguards policies. And his question is, what are the plans and strategies of the World Bank to implement free, prior, informed consent with Indigenous peoples? And also, he wants to know, since we've been participating in this dialogue, an ongoing engagement for 3 years in the policy reform process, what comes next? What will be the role of Indigenous organizations as we move forward in engaging with the bank? Does the process continue or will it be cut off?
Thank you. I've got gentleman right at the front and then two behind him. Please go to the microphone.
I'm Miguel Schloss. I'm from Chile. Maybe the wrong person to talk about this. I find the presentations brilliant, articulate, intelligent, convincing, typical World Bank presentations. When you take a step back and hear at all these cases, what one wonders is, you know, all this sounds very project-focused, very process-oriented, very labor-intensive, and I wonder whether there is any thought being given to maybe take a bit of a broader view and see what is necessary so that countries can develop these types of issues in a less labor-intensive way, in a less institutionally intensive way, because most of our countries are institutionally weak. What can be done to simplify and yet respond organically on their own on these issues? Hopefully without the World Bank. I am talking in these terms because I come from a country that has been very distant from the World Bank, and I have been myself involved in building up certain types of institutions in Papua New Guinea, in the Amazons in Brazil, and so that others can do the kinds of things, whether it's private sector companies or it is mining companies, to interact in a manner that you build up this responsiveness to the local population. As I say, in a sum, very brilliant. I wonder whether it's a broader way, a simpler way that has a bigger multiplying effect. Thank you.
Thank you, yes. Gentleman in the checked shirt. On this side, and then the gentleman in the checked jacket.
Yeah, thank you very much for giving me, can you hear me? This opportunity, and thank you for the good report. Like you said, excellent report, and academic and stuff and things like that, very good. I have seen a lot of improvement with the inspection panel. I've been interacting with the inspection panel for a couple of years now, especially with projects in Kenya. And so I have seen a lot of improvement in terms of, you know, what is coming out and your recommendations. That's great. But I want to make a couple of recommendations and ask one question. One of my recommendations is that I'm a researcher. I just finished my doctorate in international community development at Clemson. I'm specializing on the impact of multi-sectoral investments in among indigenous people in Africa. And this takes me aback. It's one thing to say you are involving, one thing to say FPIC, and one thing to leave it on the projects. What I'm saying, a recommendation that from an environmental needs assessment to the completion of the project, there has to be indigenous experts. When you take in an expert from New York or DC to go to an environmental impact assessment among the forest people for Eastern Africa, this guy goes there with a Eurocentric focus, a Western focus. He doesn't understand. He may have a million degrees, but he does not know the context of those people. You need to move a step further and bring in indigenous experts to your whole process. That is the thing. About anthropology, we are moving from anthropology to indigenous humanities. Let us do our research. Let us do our observations from our own perspective. And finally, I would want to make a comment about the recent visit of the panel to Kenya. I am a victim of that project, the geothermal project. I was among the first people that raised the red flag. I contributed a lot of information that the World Bank used to go and look at the project. Unfortunately, and this is a question that I'm being asked, my people know that I'm here. The panel identified a lot of issues, but unfortunately, and even despite some of the civil society members lobbying the World Bank directors, the World Bank went ahead to give Kenya money, and yet there were issues that were withstanding. This is the question. The World Bank, on one hand, says great thing. The World Bank, on the other thing, continues to fund a project that is continuing to do damage to the community. How can you balance that? That what you say is wrong should not be funded.
My name is Obid Ligate. I'm an independent researcher, and I am originally from Tanzania, but I'm based in DC. My question will be directed to Alex as an African representative. So the little knowledge I gather about indigenous people, first of all, I want to know what is the definition of an indigenous person? Because for my little understanding in Africa, our land is not surveyed. You know, I can buy land from somebody. We just sign by the village chairman, and then that's how people own land. And that's almost 70% of the population in Africa. And they mostly own 1 acre to 1.5 acres. That's kind of standard all around Africa. Now, in such a scenario, my question is that the government, what is the government role in protecting the rights of their people, irrespective of indigenous? Because these people, majority of them own 1 acre of land. So if they sell it to get a bridge or a dam or anything else, that dam can help the indigenous people, yes. But how about that person who's got only 1 acre and you compensate him? Is there any effort of tracking the progress, the livelihood of that person after 1 year? What is the state of that person in terms of livelihood? That's another thing. Another thing is that the work of the panel, I can see it's very much ex post. I would prefer it should be ex ante, and because these things, the World Bank has been conducting projects for many years, and these lessons should actually have been picked up already, because we see these conflicts happening again and again, impacting indigenous people. So I would encourage it to be ex ante, and we shouldn't be reactory, we should be more proactive. Thank you.
I'll take one more question for gender diversity. There's a lady just here, and then I've seen your other hands. We'll come to you in the second round.
My name is Alessandra. I'm from Brazil. I am an expert, have been working with communities, traditional communities, for the last 16 years, and mostly in Amazon, Brazilian Amazon. And talking about safeguard, we had some projects in Amazon with NORAD, and one of the documents that that they asked for to start the project, to start even giving money for the project, is when the project goes through additional areas or traditional community areas, like forest communities, it's a document that we must give them, a statement of those communities to start the project. They agree with the project. So I think this is something that he was talking about Venezuela, I forgot his name, from the Venezuela. And this is something that is happening with NORAD. I know that because I was the director of this project. So I want to know if in the World Bank, is there any kind of document statement that we need to present before starting the project, like this kind of statement that the communities agree with the project? Not even projects in infrastructure areas, but projects, reports or research, whatever, what kind of projects, doesn't matter.
Okay. Okay, thank you. I think Mahindra will start with you, since many of the questions are focused on you, but we'll come to the other two panelists as well, who I think will have points to add.
Sure. It's an excellent set of questions. So on the issue of free, prior, and informed consent, there is a need for a lot of guidance for how to actually implement it in projects. So that's what we are working on now. So there will be an effort on that. And we have been having the discussions with our indigenous friends over the past several years. So we will have a conversation with them on the FPIC issue also, whether the way the guidance develops makes sense, is implementable, is reasonable. So we'll do that. And then quite apart from that, there is the partnership is going to continue to guide us and work with us on both operationalizing, on implementing the new framework, but also on what I mentioned, what else can we do to promote more indigenous people-centric and focused development. So that conversation will continue. We will have a discussion. And in fact, we are right now trying to sort out within the bank how to take that forward, but you will hear from us very soon on that. Then there was a question on, so that's a little bit for the panel, and then it's a little bit for me, the question on, this is a very rigid, not rigid, but this is very elaborate, very complex way of implementing development. So I was thinking about it, and I think two thoughts come to mind. One, if you consult with people and if you work with them and if it's sort of co-produced, co-thought through, co-designed, I think then it can be more of a conversation and a consultation and not a formal process. So that's one. And two, on the institutional part, I don't think there is getting around saying that institutions are weak and therefore let's figure out some other way. On that, I think, and I was hoping that you will say, why not focus then on helping build stronger institutions? Why does the World Bank work on at the project level and work with that institution and build a little capacity? Why not focus on capacity building as a very important development objective in itself? And then, because that we are finding in project after project after project. So I don't think we should skirt that issue. I just think that we need to kind of rise to the challenge to address that head on. So then there was a question on how we can do projects better. So there are so many problems, and in many of these projects, how do you do better? I think this is a contribution we learn. As we implement, we make mistakes. That's the spirit of this whole session, and the effort on the part of inspection panel is actually to learn from what we have done in the past and then to do better over time. And the point about when to consult, I think the dilemma is that before we have a concept about a project or a program or a study, you don't really know what to consult, what to talk about. So the way it works in the World Bank in our projects is that we spend some time getting the contours, the outline of a project sort of figured out. And then before it is finalized or before it's given any concrete shape, we do the consultations. So that's a more appropriate time. Otherwise, there is a risk that we will consult on some broad principles, broad issues, which might sound reasonable, and then come up with the project which actually may have a problem on the ground. So that's a time when we consult. And then
that's gonna work. I think I just one question, and I'm really not sure whether we could start that debate of who is indigenous in Africa. I can only go straight to the point by saying that the African Commission on Human and People's Rights has conceptualize a concept and given it a specific understanding of what it means and what it does not mean. As there is a report that I really recommend you to access to. It's an African Union document, official document, published in 2005, and you can find it on the African Commission website. It doesn't mean all Africans. It does go specific to a number of community for one single reason. Because the concept in the last 15 years has been attached a protective regime, a protective mechanism and set of right principles that are devised to redress some specific historical issue that certain community faced. And that report of the African Commission on Human People's Rights did prove indeed that there were communities, some communities in Africa, that had experienced similar. Just one comment on, I think, as I said, in my view, there is a lot in the new ESS-7, in my view, a lot, and it will depend on how it's implemented, and I think really the real work has started. I think it could make tremendous change, positive change, that specific standard, but I also think it can actually become unworkable if the appropriate tools and implementation doesn't surround the what is in there. And I think that's the only few comments I want to make. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Gonzalo.
Thank you very much. It's hard to follow these two speakers. They are so engaging, and Maninder's anecdotes are just amazing. So, and I think they answer most of the questions. Let me just say two things. One, on this issue of the higher level approach to development that goes beyond the project, I think that's a very important concept. But of course, the panel responds to complaints that are at the project level and the bank's unit of intervention is the project. But what we found interesting is that when we started to do this emerging lesson series, we tried to figure out a methodology. And the methodology we're using, as I mentioned, is something very simple, which is a frequency analysis. How often are these issues coming up? And they just keep coming up again and again and again. So the fact that development is implemented through projects is not necessarily allowing the lessons to be fed back into the learning. And I think that's a very major issue that needs to be addressed, not just by the World Bank, but by development institutions at large. So that's why we're doing this lesson series. Now, one of my first cases with the panel was chaired by President Kim, and he said basically to the staff three things about the panel cases. First, if you make a mistake, admit it. Second, if there is a problem, fix it. And then third, don't do it again. And with this type of emerging lesson series, what we're trying to do is to help the bank on that third aspect, which is if there are errors, don't do them again. Thanks.
Wise advice. A lady at the back who's been desperate to speak, please come forward.
Thank you. My name is Reverend Bokwe Burnley, and I really want to thank you for giving me this opportunity. I'm so grateful for what the panel has been doing and the presentations and this report. And I read the first one, and even this one is quite good, and the presentation and the lessons learned are quite good. I just want to make a suggestion. I right from reading the very first one that was launched, I thought it might add more value, it might make it more practical if we added a questionnaire, a guided questionnaire to these reports, because for example, we have these 6 lessons here. And it's clear that we have been saying these are the lessons learned. And somehow it seems like the people are not getting the lessons. Let me give an example. For example, lesson number 5, it says active supervision enables proper responses to changing circumstances. So for example, if we had a questionnaire for lesson number 5, which just common sense questions like, what instruments have you put in place to make sure that there's continuous supervision, you know, for the project, the people who are writing the projects, they just need to fill in what instruments they have put in place. So that if they don't have those instruments, then we already know that there's going to be a problem because they have not made any provisions for continuous supervision. For example, same thing with lesson 6. For example, it says here, projects must respect customary land and resource rights. And then, so we have an easy common sense question like, what customary land rights have you noticed in that area? For example, if they don't have any list of rights that they have noticed, then we already know we are going to have problems with them because there is no way they can be going into a place to do a project and there are people there that don't have customs. So I just felt that if using this exact same 6 lessons, we could develop a simple pointed guided questions that will help the people writing the projects. They will fill it out, they will answer the projects, because sometimes somebody brings a huge big project and we don't have the time to go through everything. But with the questions, you know that they have done their homework, and with the answers to those questions, it's easy to supervise them and to follow them up and to make sure that they are staying focused on what the World Bank goals are and what the goals are for the communities that they want to represent. Thank you.
The gentleman in the blue, I think it's a blue shirt. Stripes, there you go. No, sorry, let's have the guy in the stripes first and the check blue shirt can go after.
Okay, thank you for this opportunity. I'm Yator Kiptum. I'm here representing Sengwer Forest Indigenous Community from Kenya. And I want to say that I want to thank the inspection panel for the work they did, because actually I was one of those who are behind the filing of the complaint that was made by the Sengwer community with respect to the natural resource management project. So I want to thank the inspection panel actually for having time to visit the community, I think twice, and to thank them for the recommendation they made, because I think the recommendation they made, their final report, which was approved by the bank board members, actually came after the end of the project. But I think they made a very significant recommendation, and that was actually to have dialogue process as a result of the problems that we incurred during the implementation of the project. So we've had the dialogue process as the chairman of the inspection panel was giving in this report early last year in March. So we had this national colloquium where we actually acknowledge the support given by the bank by ensuring that they brought in experts from other countries that have had similar cases like the single people have been going through. For example, the protein expert from Bolivia, where as a country, they have been able to recognize the rights of forest indigenous communities to live within their ancestral lands in the protected area. And actually, there have been a remarkable achievement of the protected area after having recognized the rights of these forest communities. But I just want to make one maybe 2 or 3 observations on the dialogue process. the recommendation was made to have a dialogue between the forest community, the Singwer and others, and the Minister of Environment and government in general. But who was to be in charge of the dialogue process? Because we had this dialogue process last year in March, but that was the end of it. Was the dialogue process supposed to be just a one-day meeting or a 2 days meeting, and that was the end of it? I think dialogue is a process. So I don't know, in the recommendation, who was actually supposed to supervise that dialogue process. Because after the meeting last year, nothing has happened until July this year, as a result of initiative of the community and other partners, were able to have the National Land Commission to lead the dialogue process. And now pulling in the World Bank to come and support the dialogue process. So I want to say that for the success of the dialogue process, I think the bank should take a leading role to make sure that it really achieves the goals that were earmarked to achieve. And secondly, one of the reasons why the dialogue process had not taken place after last year, we have not had any meetings as a follow-up is because of a lack of financial support. So we requested the bank to support that process. Because if there's no support, I think we are not going to achieve much from the dialogue process. And another thing is the need to build the capacity of the indigenous communities to participate or to engage in the dialogue process effectively. As my colleague from Kenya was saying, about the case of the Olkaria Maasai, one of the failures is that the community representatives who are in the mediation process, they don't have the capacity to engage in that process. So it's the same even for the Segwer community. So I think it's important to build the capacity of the indigenous communities so that they be able to engage actively in the process. And lastly, also request the panel and the bank to support further meetings between the community and the Ministry of Environment, KFS, KWS, and also other development partners that are involved in conservation-related projects in Kenya. For example, the Finnish government, we have IUCN, we have European Union, who are actually doing other projects related to conservation. And lastly, as a result of the Segwer people filing the complete inspection panel, I think want to thank the bank because of suspending the Red Plus projects in Kenya. Because that one, if that would have continued, I think given the situation we are currently in, because even after the dialogue process, even after the meeting last year, even after the World Bank president meeting with the president of Kenya and assuring that the issue of Segwer will be resolved, I think the situation has become worse. Because unlike the time when the inspection panel visited the community, I think they were able to get into the forest, meet with the people in the forest, but I think now it has been restricted. There's no, people cannot be allowed to get into the forest to meet with the community. When you ask where there are people in the forest, the government always denies that there are no people inside the forest, but our people are living in the forest. Yes, they have burned down all our houses, but we are living in caves. We are living in in the thick forest hiding, inside the, in the forest. So I want to say thank you for the inspection panel, and I hope you will be able to support the process so that now we can be able to achieve the goals set for the dialogue process. Thank you.
Thank you. Now, I'm afraid in a minute I'm going to fail in my only job, which is to keep us to time. So I'm very sorry, particularly to the gentleman in the blue check shirt. Please come and ask your question after to the panel. I'm going to turn to the panel and ask you just to do 1 minute each with your responses. And apologies to all of those who didn't get their questions asked.
Thank you. I think most of the questions are for Maninder, so I leave him most of the time. But a quick comment on Yator's comment on the Kenya case on the natural resources management. I think it illustrates some of the limitations of the process, and sometimes this hope that somehow a panel case is going to solve all of the problems. We were able to find some weaknesses, which led the bank to do this land colloquium, which is now setting in motion some procedures and processes that hopefully will result in solving some of these issues. But let's not forget that you have a bank project and a panel case on top of a context that is much more complex. Some of these historical legacy issues were there before, and unfortunately it's probably going to take a long time to get fully solved. So at least I think that we are satisfied that we put our grain of sand in this process, but it is a much more longer term issue, and that, I think that shows some of the limitations of how far we can go.
So not to answer any questions, but we will follow up on the Kenya situation. So I don't know the details, but we will follow up on that and see what's happening with the dialogue and how it can be supported to continue, because it did. I do know that it was going on for a while and it was very useful. So we will look at that again. Also, I'm sure in the audience there are, so that was my main request or plea, is that there are in the audience, you may have suggestions, ideas, any useful papers which document some of the best approaches to promoting indigenous people inclusive development. So please, I would request you to send those to us. That's one way of continuing this conversation. So I am mgill@worldbank.org. Maninder Gill is my name, and everyone in the bank has the first initial and then last name, mgill@worldbank. Please send it to us, and that way we'll make sure that we continue this dialogue beyond the session. And then when we meet next time, we can take stock of that, and we can give you some account of what we have done with your ideas, how we've thought about them, and how we've taken them on board. Thank you very much.
Madam Chair, I think I don't have anything to add. Just to thank again for the organizers. You have the floor, please.
Thank you. So it only leaves me to say thank you very much to our panelists. I think you've given us an incredibly engaging hour and a half here today, and I've certainly learnt a lot. Thank you to our audience that has stayed very focused throughout and given us brilliant questions. A quick advertisement that the next report is on environment and social assessment, released early next year. In the meantime, we'll all absorb these findings. I think it's incredibly important the inspection panel is doing this so that we can make sure that in the way that we implement the safeguards going forward and the new ESS 7, that we do so in a good way. So thank you very much, everyone, today for coming.